least take a shot at it. And all of our Bible scholars here, I think we can do just fine. So if you have a phone or if you have a Bible, I would suggest opening to Hebrews chapter 11. Then if you have a mobile device, open another tab to Genesis. So we'll be between those two books this morning. But this whole, if you ever read Hebrews chapter 11, I definitely recommend it. It's entitled Faith in Action. And the writer of the Hebrews goes through and takes all these Old Testament people and talks about their faith, how they put it into action. But our first question Pastor Bullhorn has for us today is, faith is blank. So we read the first couple verses here. Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. The word of our Lord. So what is faith? If we could make a group definition today of faith, what would we make it? What are some things you maybe heard? We have some notes here. Pastor Lauren says in verse 1, talks about assurance. It's the assurance of what we do not see. We have hope. We have certainty. We have sight. In verse 3, by faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that were visible, that are visible. And looking at 6, faith and good works, without faith it's impossible to please God. So what's a definition that we can come up with this morning? Say, faith is blank.
Faith is believing in something that you don't necessarily have proof.
That you don't necessarily what?
Have proof.
Okay, Taya says faith is something that you have confidence in that hasn't necessarily been proven. Good starting point. Anybody else have any other things they want to add to a definition challenge? Confidence in something we haven't proven? They could be part of it, but there's also that part on the other end where it says it's in relation with faith and good works. Right? So faith is something that has, maybe hasn't necessarily been proven. Maybe it's on a secular side, right? We also have faith in something that has been proven and will come and we'll see the fulfillment of it on Judgment Day. Right? We have faith that the Savior died for us, lived that perfect life, but we weren't here to see it. Right? Like I said, I don't have all the answers. Craig.
So just having faith that God is providing for us day in and day out, you know, say people, you know, lose a job or COVID-19 times, things like that. God is, he's always promised that he'll provide our daily needs, you know.
Okay. So faith is the assurance God will provide. Okay. Tay, do you want to add to your answer? I think we can say it somewhere else, right? Faith is confidence in what we haven't seen, confidence in the promise, and faith is blind. It's blind. We can't see. It's all about trust, right? We trust. We have the confidence that trust that our Savior is there for us. right? And without faith, we're spiritually dead as well. So let's look at our heroes here, heroes of faith. And there's a bunch of them listed in Hebrews 11. And Pastor Uhorn only had a couple. It starts with Abel and Enoch, which we read about already a little bit. Noah. Abraham and Sarah are two friends from Pastor's Perfect Couple class. Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, and then Moses. He does mention a few more later. So let's get to number one, Abel. Hebrews 11 verse 4 once again says, "By faith Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith Abel still speaks even though he is dead." And if you remember the story of Cain and Abel, right? Adam and Eve's kids, Cain and Abel. Cain was the one outdoorsman. Abel was the tender one. They both make offerings to God. God accepts Abel's. And Cain gets mad and kills him. Right? But why was Abel's offering accepted over Cain's? Okay. So, what is Abel's act of faith? What did he do when they were doing the offering, following this thing? It all comes down to his offering. Diane?
I would say that Abel loved God, okay, and Cain did not, even though they both knew God and spoke with him quite literally.
Right. Abel loved God, right? He gave the offering with a servitude heart. Right? It wasn't forced. It was out of pure love for his Lord. Dawn?
Probably goes back to like the verse 6 thing, the relationship that Abel had with God versus maybe lack of relationship that his brother had with God, and that building, that one-on-one where it's his, your best friend, and this is what I, you do that for me, this is what I'd love to do for you. So, relationship.
Versus lack of. Okay. Dan?
I guess we can't take any credit for faith, correct?
Right.
I mean, it's all the Holy Spirit, that's it. So if Cain and Abel had different levels of faith, I'm a bit at a loss to understand if neither of them are responsible for having more or less faith based upon the Holy Spirit, how do I go from there to understand one having more faith than another?
Right, but there's ways that we can strengthen or decrease our faith, right, or weaken it, right? God says in the Bible, if we're coming and meeting together, we're all going to strengthen our faith together, right? We build each other up, our faith. And what happens when we're not in church or we're not hearing the word settling? We have a much more easier time giving into temptation, right, and weakening our faith. So, right, it's through the Holy Spirit, but we can't also judge a person's heart, right? That's very true. Steve?
Had a teacher once explain that you got to be pretty good at getting out of the way of the Holy Spirit.
Intentionally.
So faith is there, but we're pretty good at watching that and getting in the way of it. Apparently that's what Cain was having troubles with, his envy, whatever it might have been, his feelings towards his older brother, or his younger brother, thank you. That's getting in the way of faith, wasn't it?
Right. Right, like our own personal interests be on the top of our faith. True. So what words can we use to describe Abel? What are some words? I think we can say he's, Dawn talked about his relationship with God. We talked about how Abel loved God, so we can say there's a lot of words we can use here. If you have a second, you can come back to Genesis and take a peek at Genesis 4. comfortable what I would use to describe it, like generous or first fruits. He's given the full fat portion of his offering, the fat from some of the first part of his flock. So I don't use the word generous, but
full of gratitude.
Full of gratitude, yeah. There we go. Thanks, Craig. If you look through Genesis 4, there's not a word that the Lord actually uses to describe it.
Would hypocrite be? I don't know if it was already said. But hypocrite comes to mind.
What do you think of Abel? Why?
Oh, sorry, Cain. Sorry.
Oh, so Cain's a hypocrite. All right, we'll put that on the side note.
Sorry.
Right? Now, the next part Pastor Lord has is that we know we apply it. In what times might it be useful to call to mind the faith of Abel?
That might be a good time to call to mind his faith.
Taya? Okay, so coming, Taya said, coming to church with the right heart, not just coming to go through the motions. How easy could that have been this morning, right? As soon as Steve got up front and said, hey, I'm not Pastor Littlehorn, how many would have turned off right there? Right? But coming here with the full heart, right? Make sure we're saying the words, meaning the words. Right? I think of just even also giving offerings, right? You just want something on the plate, just, oh, I have to fill my envelope this week. Right? You're giving your offering to the Lord out of thanks, right? Steve is really just saying it's out of thanks for our Lord. Not because we have to, because we want to. Any other instances come to mind? Don.
What about living in a world of criticism, which his brother might have done, or comparisons where, you know, I can do it better than you, or you aren't doing it as well as I. Those types of circumstances, we just have to remember it's the heart, our personal heart, not anyone else's, that God looks at.
Right, that's a good idea. That's a good thought too, yeah. Comparing and not always having to be in the one up, except we're doing it out of our heart. That's, yeah. All right. Any other thoughts on Abel before we move on to Noah? Alright, Noah is Hebrews 11 verse 7, which reads, by faith Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith he condemned the world and became the heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith. If you know the story of Noah, right, wickedness was in the world. And the Lord said, build this ark, I'm going to flood the earth, right? I'm going to destroy everything. Right? I'm getting rid of this wickedness. And the only people he was bringing on the ark were him, his wife, his three sons, and their wives, and two of every kind of animal and creature. Right? I actually gave a chapel on this a couple months ago. And just think of Noah for a second. Right? They're in the middle of deserts or vegetation, but there's not really water around. And God tells you to build this big ark, this big boat. There's no water around, and I'm going to flood the earth. How crazy do you think Noah thought God was? Right? There's no water around, but build this massive ark. And everybody's going to make fun of you for it, but still build it. I personally, that's his act of faith, building the craziness. Right? There's nothing around there to like, warrant this boat. Yet he still has the trust and the confidence in God to build it. If anybody's ever seen Evan Almighty, the movie, it's very loosely based on the Bible. But right, he gets heckled the whole time with his ark. But that's where I have his act of faith, because he's building in the middle of nowhere. That makes no sense whatsoever. Dan.
It brings a thought to mind, which I mentioned earlier, is holy fear. I mean, fear is fear. And Noah had holy fear. But so it's holy, it's not self-centered, but it is still fear not to do what God has told you to do. Does that make sense?
So, fear is still what happens when you build it out of holiness, not out of
human fear.
Right.
But I mean, it's still fear for God. And fear or love, I guess you could say. But it's holy fear.
Right.
That's why he could withstand all of the downside of building an ark in a desert.
Right. That holy fear that leads with love, the trust, the respect. Right? You should fear and love God, right? That holy fear. You should love and trust Him. Alright? Can we think of some words that come to mind when you think of Noah? We can use positive or negative words of Noah. Is there any downside to Noah if you read the Bible? Taya?
Trust.
Trust? Or trusting?
Brave.
Righteous, the Lord, it's right in the Bible. Noah was a righteous man.
Prophetic.
Okay. How so, Don?
He relayed the message that God had given him to the earth to repent because destruction is coming.
Right, and people listen to him?
Of course not.
Of course not. Taya? Okay, I think that's a fair word. Does anybody disagree? Doubtful. I mean, we're all human nature by sin. Steve?
Maybe tied with what Tate is saying there. Doubtful. Probably full of, you want to say, resentment towards his neighbors, but he was above that, wasn't he? Because he kept at it for 100 years.
Right.
So he's very persistent, I think, was the word I was saying.
Persistent, okay. Right. How many times do you think, I mean, God, because we're righteous man and all this. Like we're saying, how many times did he have resentment? Or he doubted? Right? There were 100 years in the desert building this ark. That probably creeped into sort of simple nature at some point. Right? Or it was simple. Okay? Anybody else have any words? Barb.
He was self-confident.
Self-confident. How so?
He was doing the right thing. He listened to God. He knew that God was making mistakes. He was self-conscious that he was doing the right thing.
Right? Even though, like, I talked to him, it seemed absolutely crazy, right? But he's still confident this is what the Lord wanted him to do. Don,
it was like, I can't put it in words so well.
Okay, sounds good. All right, so in what times might it be useful to apply this, to call to mind the faith of Noah?
When it seems that God is expecting the impossible of you,
okay.
Which is illogical thing of you.
So I have, it feels like God expecting the illogical. Oh, is that a fair way to put it, Don? Okay. I like when I preach my chapel, I talk about COVID. I think of our world right now, how crazy it is. And yes, no one wants to wear a mask, right? It's not fun. Or yes, you have to socially distance, right? But that's where that trust comes in, right? You just have to trust the Lord's going to get you through this. It seems illogical, right? After all the research, whether you're on this side of the mask or this side, we're not going to get political with that this morning. But just trusting, having that faith that this may seem absurd, the Lord's going to get you through it at the same time.
I think there's a lot of times in life where you feel called by God to do something, and other people in your life do not agree. And, you know, we've personally gone through that a lot. Family is, we are called to do something where our family doesn't agree, and still moving forward with that faithful call of God
work at this art for 100 years and stick with this whole thing.
Right? In the face of temptation, perseverance. Okay. All right, Mr. Don, sorry.
I think going again back to that relationship with God, like when Adam and Eve got to walk and talk with God, we don't know exactly, because it's not revealed in scriptures, just how much time he actually didn't say, okay, correct, blah, 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 but really directly communicated with them, because they didn't have written scriptures.
Right.
So there had to have been more of a walk, talk kind of thing than there is now, because now God uses the word and called people and, you know, get what I'm trying to say?
Right, so Noah's having, I'll say, struggles when he turned to God, some kind of communication we probably have, and today we turn to the scripture. A pastor put it this way to me once, so think like Noah, right, think of Adam and Eve, think of Jesus dying on the cross, or any other part of the Bible that you wish you could have been there, how nice would it have been to be a fly on the wall just to see it all happen, right? I mean, this is one of those instances where we wish we would have known more, but like the Lord says, he reveals to us what he wants us to know. Someday, we'll know the rest of the story. Alright, let's turn the page. We're moving on to Abraham and Sarah. Two parts to Abraham here. And we'll read it in two sections as well. Back to Hebrews 11. We get into our perfect couple, as Pastor put it. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. That ends the first part of our reading. So based on these select verses, if you have a moment, turn back to Genesis 17 and 18. What is the act of faith here, or acts of faith of Abraham and Sarah? Dan.
For me, it's pretty clear, because Abraham listened to God. He talked, God talked to him. And I supposedly Sarah too. But how can a little coot convince the whole group to go with him and to do all this stuff? I mean, that to me is just remarkable, that his family, he was able to convince them to pick up and go and do all this stuff. I just look at us as rational people. Now we say, we're not going. We're going to tie him up for a while.
Right, as we were talking about last week, or 2 weeks ago, right? It was the faith of grabbing and saying, let's go. It's on a whim in a sense. Or it spoke to us, get moving. It'd be like me or somebody going to like the hour, like, hey, Dan Meyer, guess what? Today you're moving to Texas. Keep going. Like you said, rational today. I'd be like, what? But I was with him through faith, not going to a place he didn't know, took his whole family and went. And remember, they did not take the short route. They went up and around and down. They went up the river. Another act of faith I think of is, like you talked about the stars. Right? Abraham gets looking at the stars, and God says, these are going to be the number of your descendants. And how many kids does he have at that point? Zero? Does he have any? Yeah, oh, look at the stars. And we can go outside here and look at stars in the countryside on a very dark night. The full moon's out, good luck. I've had the joy of going to be in Hawaii and Mount Haleakala. Going out there at 2 a.m. in the morning, it's pitch black. And I think that's maybe the closest I've ever come to thinking that I'm like Abraham. There are so many stars, you can't even begin to count them. You lose count after so many. So
So that's a plug for Hawaii today for all of you to go there, experience like Abraham. But just that's so many, right? It came, it's come true. But to tell Abraham, this is what's going to happen to you if he has no kids, that takes a lot of faith. That trust, that confidence in what we haven't seen yet, as Taya said, and also that God's going to provide, like Craig said, right? For what's going to do that. Any other acts of faith? So we have moving the family at God's command. And believing in the promise. How about Sarah? Where's Sarah's act of faith here? If we look back at verse 11, it says, "By faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who has made the promise." So Sarah's act of faith is just, in this case, believing that the child, that she can still have a child, right? Believing that the Lord would provide. Now, not to get off in the weeds here for a second, but this makes me think of something. The question is, so they live for over 100 years, or even before that, hundreds of years. Yet it still says where Sarah is at this point, she's past childbearing age. So was it similar to what we have today? Was it extended, the period of childbirth for families? I don't know, and we don't know. But it just brings an interesting thought into that. But she was past the childbearing age, right? She still had that trust, that confidence that she would have a child. So what's a couple of words in this case that we can use to describe Abraham and Sarah? Just a couple of words. Dan, go ahead. I know you have one on the tip of your tongue back there.
Oh, wow.
Alright. How can we describe Abraham and Sarah?
Hopeful.
Hopeful? How, Don, explain just so we can flush it out.
That God keeps promises, that from them they would have many children. That gives you something to look forward to. And then eventually they have a permanent city instead of living in tents.
Right.
So there's lots of things upon which to focus their hope in a God who is faithful.
Which, a lot of things they couldn't see at the time, right? Physically see. We also have another word at all? Craig?
I have to say impatient.
Patient?
Impatient.
Impatient. Explain it.
Because they did take matters into their own hands and try to create their own life and their own promises by having children alongside of Sarah.
Right. And we didn't talk about today, but yes, that's the rest of the story. Right? Ishmael, right? So they're taking matters into their own hands. Because they were not patient. That's a very good one.
But then they went down. They stuck with God.
So patient, but they come back around to, I don't know if we're patient, but I don't want to say persevere, because they go, that's a good one, I don't know. Or we're being sick there. Right? Impatient, they come back around to trust. Really messed up.
Right? I'm seeing doubtful.
Doubtful?
Yeah, because I'm reading Genesis 18, when Sarah laughed and said, "Well, I really have a child now that I'm old. How is that possible?" And then she also lied to God when she said she didn't laugh about that. So I'm seeing God.
So they have their faith, they're hopeful. At the same time, they're not as trusting as we think. Like Noah wasn't the case, right? They try to take it in their own hands here, or they laugh at God at the same time. But what are some times where it might be useful in our lives to call to mind the faith of Abraham and Sarah? Diane.
I immediately think, well, if they can do it, I can do it. But not because of my own power, you know. Instead, again, going to the basic Holy Spirit, the faith, and
Okay, so God's in control. They can do it, we can do it. Oh, go ahead, Don.
In the Hebrews verse,
yep,
11, I never marked this because this is all marked up, but I had to mark the fact that Abraham was enabled, that God gives you what you need at the time you need it if you don't even have it, so that he sends an enabler, the Holy Spirit, or whatever power we need in order to accomplish what he wants us to do. Not, of course, on our own.
Craig, if you're on the sidebar, second go ahead.
Yeah, just, you know, at times in our life where we feel that calling from God, and yet we may laugh at God or doubt God, that God still sticks with Abraham and necessarily that he will still stick with us, even though we're going to stumble and fall, make mistakes, and maybe not do things we should do, like sharing that faith publicly. And have those opportunities to reach out to the needy or share our faith, and we don't. You know, God doesn't hold those against us. He still has grace, and he still carried out his promises despite our weaknesses.
Right? So God will stick with us in tough times. He also gives us through his grace, like Steve talked about this morning. God's grace. Go ahead, Steve.
That's kind of tying with Craig. Maybe you said this, Craig. So. Sorry if you try to ground here. But God sticks with us even when we're knuckleheads. Those of you that grew up with siblings, you know that God places us with siblings so we never get an ego. They help to make us make sure we understand that we're not the sharpest knife in the drawer. Abraham, I think Sarah was a wonderful woman to have done and stayed with them the way she did. But I'm sure even his own conscience kept bothering him about the stuff he had done that wasn't what God had enabled him to do or expected him to do. And yet that faith stayed there. God loved him for it and helped him in his strength. So it helps me when I'm in the middle of remembering some of the knuckleheaded things I've done. And yet God stuck with me.
If you didn't hear Stevie's talk about we do knucklehead things, as knucklehead as they may be, God still loves us. He's still with us. And we are not the sharpest knives.
You might.
No.
Yeah.
You know, I think too of, you know, God comes through in the improbable, right? That's kind of what we're talking here too with all stars, right? Most improbable thing, he's going to provide for you the way he sees it, or he sees it. That's part one of Abraham. Let's go to part two, unless somebody else has something else for Abraham part one. Nope, okay. Continuing Hebrews 11. By faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promises were about to sacrifice his one and only son. Even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned," Abraham reasoned that God even raised the dead, and so in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from the dead. This one, I think out of most of them, is the clearest one. Maybe just get done talking about Abraham, and how God said, you're going to have a son, and your descendants are going to be all as big as the stars in the sky or as the grains of sand on the seashore. And now he says to sacrifice your son. The one son he'd given him to for the promise. And what does Abraham do? He takes him up the mountain, and Isaac goes, "Where's the sacrifice?" And Abraham says, You're it. And you gotta think, I mean, I don't know if you're like me, you're trying to think what's running through Abraham's head at this point. There's probably a struggle here somewhere with his personal wants, right? It's like, son. I think it was my son Maddox, I'd be really torn, right? It's a sinful nature, you're my only son, after having two girls, finally got one, but now I'll go kill him. I've faith in his Lord, that trust, he puts them on the altar, right? He's willing to sacrifice his only son for the Lord. Can anybody think of any other acts of faith in this, maybe? I think that's the main one.
I also wonder about the faith of Isaac.
Okay, go ahead.
The Bible doesn't tell us a struggle between Abraham and Isaac when Abraham is tying him down and going to slay him. And so was there faith in Isaac to some degree of there must be a plan here?
Right. Well, we'll talk about it, right? Like you said, but you wonder. Right? All those moments where you wish you knew a little more story.
Yeah, I know, holding down my 12-year-old and trying to scream like crazy. Keep running. I mean, a lot of shrieking and a lot of screaming.
Right, okay. It's a good thought, right? It's a thought we can't answer, but a good question to pose. Steve?
I think Dan said it well when he's talking about Abraham had the kind of faith that people trusted enough that they would follow him through the desert to a new spot. That is a strong faith. I appreciate that, Dan. That's a strong faith that's strong enough that others can tell, wow, he has that much faith in God. I will follow. Must have been something like that with Isaac.
Right.
But I agree, too, that Isaac's faith certainly was strong at that moment. My goodness.
And trust his dad.
Yeah.
And kids, they trust their parents, don't they? Part. Right? So you're going somewhere, they're not going to trust that's where you're going until you prove them wrong enough times where, oh, we're on McDonald's, and then you go home instead of McDonald's. But something like that. Words to describe Abraham at this point. I would use the word selfless. The fact that he's willing to give it up, what he wants for God.
Obedient.
Steadfast.
Steadfast.
Right. Say wiser. Yeah. Kind of stressed because they doubted him so much in the first time that they were going to have a son that, you know, he said, well, God can go at this time. I guess.
That's a good point, right? Craig says wiser in the fact of first time around they kind of doubted God with the son. But now he's wise enough that he's willing to sacrifice them, knowing that God's plan is there somewhere. But he wisened up a little bit in his old age. Any other words? All right, when are some times might it be useful to call upon to mind the faith of Abraham? I think from a practical side, I mean, loosely, like I said, I literally just looked at this morning. But think about the times where, I don't know, maybe you're down to your last couple dollars in your bank. Or maybe you're down to the last, or people in the world have the last food in the fridge. Right? And you don't know what's going to be next to happen. But you give that money out, or you spend that last money in faith, knowing, it's all I got. And hopefully the Lord provides. God's got a plan somewhere. We may not know it. That person who gives out that last food or gives that last money, it's out of pure faith, knowing that God's got a plan and the promise that he's always going to provide for you when he sees fit. But there's a lot of trust there, right? Nice. Oh, Dan, thank you for not making us silent on that one.
There's, on some level, as a leader, has to convince everyone that get on the right page, this is what we're going to do. And some type of leadership that he possesses at that point in his life that enables him and others to feel confident in what they're going to be subject to. And, I think if we look back in our lives, we can all see it.
confidence, either at some point you were the leader and you were confident in your leadership, or you followed because you were confident in the person's leadership. That's a great point. Don.
I think in a world where there was no technology, nothing upon which to focus other than your surroundings, and God, you know, we are so unaware of the miracles that are going on around us all the time. I mean, we have no clue because we are so distracted with everything else. But if we really became aware of what was going on around us, I think we would be seeing miracles continually. And I honestly think that God was providing in everyday living. I mean, you have this massive amount of his ownership of animals and whatever, whatever. Some of that had to be quite overwhelmingly more than just the way of nature. I just think God was performing miracles around them so that they could easily accept, boy, God provides. He does this. He's there.
Anybody else in Abraham Part 2? Alright, Moses, our last big one. He's got a couple other little things on the next page. Moses, Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the application of blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. The word of our Lord. Moses. Right? Think of Moses when you think of the basket on the river, Nile River, going in, Pharaoh's daughter finds him. Then eventually he gets returned to his mother and he's grown up to grow up a little bit and he's back to Pharaoh's daughter. Eventually kills a slave driver, flees Egypt, comes back to lead God's people out of Egypt to his promised land. So what's Moses' act of faith? I don't think we have time to read all of Exodus 14 and 15 this morning. What is his act of faith?
His choice to be who God had selected him to be through the training he had gotten in his youth, he realized the importance of being a Hebrew from the line that would be continuing in the faith family versus go for anything. His bloodline was important to him, so he chose to go God's way versus human nature way.
So as Don said, he chose to be who God wanted him to be, God's way, versus a sinful nature's way, that was the word used. I thought he's okay being comfortable with the uncomfortable, right? How easy would it have been for him to be an Egyptian, right? Had everything he could have ever wanted. He was considered Pharaoh's daughter, right? He could have probably been in line for the throne. Could have all the riches, he had the education, and he was okay throwing it all away to be in the uncomfortable spot in Egypt, to be with his people, with his heritage, with God's people, the Hebrews. And even, just make sure I remember the right chat here. And then he comes back, right? As he's fled, as he killed the slave driver, the Lord tells him to go and lead his people out. And what's Moses' reaction? I don't have the words to speak. I'm not a good speaker. I can't do it, Lord. Right? But God says, no, you can. And I'm going to give you somebody to help you even. Right? He gives him Aaron. Accompany his words and help him with the words. Right? So being okay with being comfortable in the uncomfortable. Right? He had to be comfortable in a sense. He may have had a little reservation about it. But he stood up in the face of the people he left to take God's people with him. People that Pharaoh didn't want. So words to describe Moses. Diane?
In the beginning, you say he was humble and terrified.
Humble and terrified.
But I think, unlike, he was very different from Abraham, that for him, I think his faith and his strength and abilities as a leader grew over the years.
So we see that. So he's not right away a leader, but he comes. Right. Right, he's humble, terrified. But yet, by the time he gets back to Pharaoh, with help of Aaron, he's bold and confident.
Telling
him to let my people go. Anybody else? I don't use the word game changer, but he kind of changes the game, you know what I mean? Has everything, he's like, nope, I'm switching teams. You can always call him a traitor. The Egyptian side of things call him a traitor. But that's not always the way to look at him either, because he's traded for God's people. But if you're the Egyptian on the sinful side, you think he's a traitor. Not saying what the Egyptian way. The way he was raised. But I think your definition is great. Humble and terrified, and he just grows. And if you look at all six of these, five of these people we've looked at today, they're all leaders in different ways, or heroes of faith. And you can see that God uses different people in different ways, and not everybody's the same. Right? Dan hit on Abraham, must have had that confidence and that faith, and people just followed him. Moses, Dan just said, humble and terrified, but he grows into it. He's not there right away. God uses all different things, just like he uses all of us. Right, we all do things out of faith in different ways. Whether we teach, or whether we're talking to somebody on our job, or reaching out to our family members, or just talking to a church member, or whatever the case may be. Right, God uses all of us in different ways too. Back to Moses. What are some times where it might be useful to call to mind the faith of Moses?
I think about how hard it is to see maybe what other people have. What you don't. Moses gave that up for a more humble life. And his faith really shone. So for us to think about that, let our faith shine and let's not worry about the earthly material things.
So Amanda said, hard to see like what we give up compared to what we're going to. Letting our light shine, what was the rest of that?
Being happy with where we're at and not worrying about the material things in life.
Right. You might have a job where you make six figures. You might have all the riches you want. But maybe you're not happy with that job. Maybe you make the big paycheck and money doesn't buy everything. And you leave to go down to half that pay. It's much more, the job you much more enjoy. Right? You're being okay with that. There's give and take. Right. I like to think of, in our wells right now, we have a shortage of principals. That's a known thing, I think, if you're tuned into Synod News or CLS. Just think of, they keep asking, we were at a meeting the other day, and I said, hey, do you know anybody that can be a principal someday? Do you know any candidates, teachers, male teachers that can do that? Now, when you're in college, Steve, I don't know if you were asked this years ago, but you're asked, after they say, oh, you'd be a good principal, are you willing to be a principal? Say yes or no. Or maybe, right? But I think those all the people that weren't principals now, because maybe they were humble, maybe they were terrified of that leadership. But now they have to, now maybe they're ready. Maybe they're ready to become that leader in the school. I think that's very applicable in this case. Leadership. Anything else on Moses? Alright, if you flip the page or turn it over, we are at about an hour right now. So I'm going to let you take this home and use it as your weekly Bible study, or go through it at your own pace. Like I said, I don't have the answers, so if you'd like the answers to work through or have some comments, we can get Pastor Warren's email out there, and maybe you can ask him a question. But I think we're going to stop there for today. So we'll close with prayer this morning. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we've come together today in kind of a different way to worship you and study your word, Lord. You allowed Pastor Gilhorn to get in a still situation with his car. We pray that you have blessed them, that he's able to get out and return safely to the wall, free from injury and too much damage. Lord, we thank you for Mr. Mert this morning leading us in worship, his devotion. And Lord, thank you for allowing us to meet around your word in Bible study to look at the heroes of faith. Keep us safe as we go our separate ways today. Help us to continue to grow in our faith and realize that people use their gifts and use their faith in different ways to strengthen others and to grow their and to grow up in your word. In your name we pray. Amen. All right.
Thanks,
Dan. Yeah, not a problem. Thanks for coming.
I'll just give you guys an update. Jeannie did get an update. He got back to us. He's okay. His car's got some damage. He went in the ditch. He didn't hit anybody. He said his car had to be towed and it had some damage. But he's okay. So that's the update we've got. Thanks, Steve. Thank you, Dylan.
So, with that being said, I think we're back to the perfect couple next week. So come back for all the pastors. Dating and marriage advice via the Bible. So, all right, with that being said, have a great week. Stay safe. You're always more than welcome to stop in at school and see us.